There's a notion that fine things and truly understanding wine quality are only for those who have money. Besides my own experience in the market, like several blind tastings, some episodes that have marked the world of wine seem to suggest that all of this is just a poorly told story that has persisted for centuries. One of these episodes is shown in the documentary, Sour Grapes, 2016, which starts with the concept that wine is nothing more than a common drink made from crushed and fermented grapes. It argues that there is no real difference between homemade wine and a super sophisticated wine from a famous cellar. Is it true? Why would someone even think about that? Come with me to discover why. To prove this point, they present the story of Rudy Kurniawan, an Indonesian who built an empire around himself through buying and selling rare and extremely expensive wines in auctions. He gained great renown and became well known among wine enthusiasts. However, when he reached the peak of his success, he used his prestige and recognition to deceive wine lovers and orchestrate one of the biggest fraud schemes in history. People saw him as an incredibly cunning fraudster, but it wasn't just his audacity that stood out in this episode. What caught even more attention than the fraudster himself were the wine experts, especially those in the most exclusive circles, who fell for the Indonesian scam without suspecting anything. This detail was one of the most striking aspects of the story because the success of Rudy's fraud raises a significant question. Do these so-called wine experts really know what they're doing? Is there any real difference between wines found in supermarkets and those sold in auctions for tens of thousands of dollars? To understand the wine industry's fraud, it's crucial to know how Rudy managed to deceive even the most passionate enthusiasts without anyone suspecting anything. Before he entered the world of wine, Rudy Kurniawan, originally from Jakarta, the capital of Indonesia, moved to the United States in 1998 with a student visa to attend a university in California. However, in 2003, when he was supposed to return to his home country, he decided to stay in the United States because he had already taken the initial steps towards a promising career there. He became an illegal immigrant. Rudy's career as a taster and hunter of rare wines began in the early 2000s in a Los Angeles district called USO Engels, specifically at a renowned wine store. The young 24-year-old entered the store with a bottle of wine in hand and approached the reception. Interestingly, he didn't come to the store to buy or sell. According to the store's salespeople, Rudy was always there, showing interest in wine, wanting to know about its flavors, production, and the vineyards of origin. This way, he ended up becoming friends with the employees, who were also wine enthusiasts and were more than happy to help the young apprentice. Of course, they had no idea that the curious kid would become one of the biggest con artists in history. Even the salespeople praised him, saying that he had an excellent memory for remembering wine flavors and an enviable sense of smell and taste. In a short time, Rudy Kurniawan had learned enough about wine to get by. He engaged in conversations with experts and sometimes even pretended to be one. Around 2003, Rudy started to be noticed in Los Angeles wine circles as a regular attendee at wine tasting events and auctions, often spending thousands of dollars at each session. This unknown person quickly gained credibility in the wine society, earning a reputation for being an extravagant individual with an extraordinary palate. As his wine collection grew, Rudy would bring several of his rare bottles to tasting events and share them with guests, hosting luxurious dinners that pleased the members of that society and helped him make connections. Some collectors gave him the peculiar nickname, Dr. Conti, referencing a property in eastern France known for producing ultra-luxurious and highly sought-after wines. To give you an idea, a single bottle of Domaine de la Romanée Conti from 1993 can be found for sale in Portugal for nearly 24,000 euros. Another bottle from 2018 is available in a store in Brazil for $25,000. Rudy actively participated in auctions, buying and selling wines until 2006, which gave him enough time to acquire fine wine collections of various types. At that time, he was mentioned as possibly having the best wine cellar on earth and set a record for the highest value ever sold in a single wine auction, raising almost $25 million, surpassing the previous record by $10 million. Despite the vast quantity of exotic, rare, and extremely expensive wines that the club offered at the auction, there was no reason to suspect his bottles since everyone knew he had an extravagant collection. The following year, in 2007, he once again put several precious bottles up for auction, this time in Los Angeles. His bottles stood out on the cover of the auction catalog. However, representatives from a winery that produced some of the auctioned wines noticed something suspicious and informed the auction house that the bottles were fake. The bottles were meticulously analyzed and subsequently removed after being deemed inconsistent, as the experts put it. From then on, several batches began to present bizarre irregularities, such as bottles with impossible manufacturing dates, where the wines sold simply hadn't been produced. As suspicions started to arise and he was questioned, he only responded, "We tried our best to get it right, but it's Burgundy, and sometimes shit happens." Making it clear that he was just another victim of counterfeiters, right after one of his batches was removed from an auction. But Rudy's response didn't convince everyone, and his credibility degraded further with each new inconsistency in his batches. It was in 2009 that businessman Bill Koch, tired of Rudy's lack of shame, filed a lawsuit against the Indonesian, claiming that he knowingly sold him and other collectors fake bottles, both in auctions and privately. During this period, he was also accused of not paying a $10 million loan to a major auction house, adding fuel to the fire. And that's when his poorly told story reached the ears of an important person in the United States, the FBI. He became the subject of FBI investigations when people in his circle of friends suspected that he wasn't a victim of counterfeiters but was the counterfeiter himself. Investigators soon discovered his irregular immigration status, which made the authorities concerned about the risk of him fleeing the country. So, in the early hours of March 8, 2012, a dozen FBI agents arrived at Rudy's house in Arcadia, California, and arrested the Indonesian. After searching the house, the FBI discovered thousands of rare wine labels, hundreds of old and new corks, as well as a device for inserting them. There was a real arsenal of counterfeiting tools. Rubber stamps, glue, scissors, label molds, papers, instructions for making labels of famous wine brands, among several other fraudulent items. With so much explicit evidence, there was no doubt that the club had been counterfeiting wines for years, selling cheap wine in extremely valuable bottles. Later, it was discovered that even his name was false. His real name was Jen Wong Huang. He became known as the biggest wine fraudster in history and was sentenced to 10 years in prison in 2014, with the obligation to pay $28 million in restitution and another $20 million to the tax authorities. To this day, it's not known for certain how many victims there were in the Kurniawan case, but one thing is certain. The credibility of the wine market itself was a victim. After serving 7 years of his sentence, he was released by the justice system at the end of 2020 and, a few months later, deported by the Immigration Department, ending his stay on American soil. But the damage to the market had already been done, and in the years that followed the downfall of his scheme, one question couldn't be ignored. Do these infamous wine experts really know what they're talking about? Or is it all just a theater where each one pretends to know more than the other? Interestingly, during the years of the fraud, many experts published notes praising his wines, unable to notice the fake samples even after tasting and analyzing the subtle details that were so talked about in wine circles. Many of them even became friends with him, promoting and participating in numerous tastings of his wines, and yet they never realized what was happening. A portion of experts used this fateful episode to criticize and question the consistency of the knowledge base on which the wine market is built because no one noticed anything strange. Is there really a consensus on the flavors and characteristics of Rudy's wines, or is it all pure speculation? And if it's all just speculation, is there really a significant difference between a rare wine and a wine produced by a common winery, considering it's a massive and well-established industry? It's highly unlikely that a wine expert, who is even involved in the industry, would agree with this type of questioning, let alone admit that part of the wine's prestige is linked to an exaggerated perception of its value. The wine market has perpetuated for centuries with the premise that a good wine must be exclusive. But this is not exactly news, as it doesn't only occur in the world of wine. For a long time, this story has repeated itself, with the perceived value of a brand surpassing the real value of a product, like Balenciaga and its ridiculous but expensive products. It's all the result of an almost hypnotic marketing that leads many to pay for the perceived involvement in the creation of the product. This is because, for sure, the prices of the brand don't only consider production and distribution costs, since often the products, like clothes, are sold at prices dozens of times higher than those of other brands with equal or superior quality. In other words, the end consumer is not paying for the product itself but for the brand and the marketing strategies applied to the product. And also because some people love to be seen using expensive things. Other companies adopt similar strategies, associating their brands with the idea of luxury to sell their overpriced items. We have examples in the technology market, like Apple, in the fashion industry, like Gucci, and Rolex and its luxury watches. And many others even have luxury brand mineral water, believe it or not. In the world of wines, many people choose to pay more for bottles associated with luxury and exclusivity. But the truth is that they are not necessarily the best wines, and often they are not worth the price paid. Of course, no one is forced to buy any of these products. But the lesson it teaches wine producers is that the beverage market may be on the verge of a major change. And perhaps the end of overpriced bottles and refined knowledge is approaching. As consumers have increasingly more access to information and companies that maintain transparent and objective businesses and deliver real value, these companies are likely to excel in their relationship with consumers. It shouldn't be any different with wines. After all, buying a good wine should be as simple as gathering family and friends and enjoying a few glasses while having a good conversation. So, what do you think about the wine industry? Do you spend thousands in a single bottle of wine? Leave a comment below and share it with that friend who pretends to be a wine connoisseur. Thank you for watching and subscribe for more content like this.